everybody, and welcome back to Two Funny Astronauts. I'm Garrett Reisman, and this is...
Mike Massimino. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. So I hope you're enjoying this. I hope you think we're two funny astronauts, because if not, we got to come up with a new name for this thing, and that's a big pain in the ass.
Yeah, because we've already got a logo and a website.
Got the logo.
And all that, so... Like, we can't be like two not so funny astronauts or two astronauts who think they're funny but aren't really. We got us. But remember, we're funny for astronauts. We're not comedians.
Right.
Right.
Do not try this at home. We are not professionals.
That's right. We're doing our best.
So today we're going to talk about something that we will somehow relate to space, and that is baseball, because. There's actually a lot that Mike and I have in common, and one of those things is that we love baseball, but one of the things that we don't have in common is which team we root for, right, Mike?
Yep, you know, we've already got a couple rivalries going during this podcast that I didn't realize how deeply rooted you were in the jealousy of Hubble being a space station, because I think space station is really cool. I wish I could have gone there, but Hubble versus space station and New York and New Jersey and so on and so forth, but... Maybe the most deeply rooted rivalry is our baseball teams.
That's right. So I grew up in New Jersey, and I was a huge, and still am, a huge Yankees fan. And you are not.
I am a Mets fan, but I got to ask you one question, Garrett, comes to mind. Yeah. I remember you, were you ever a Mets fan at all, ever, when you were a little kid or something?
Okay, all right. Yeah, I have to admit, it's true that there was one summer... It must have. I'm trying to figure out when this was. This would have been probably the mid 70s. Was there a time in the mid 70s when the Mets were good?
Well, they won the World Series in 69. They went to the World Series in 73. They were in the World Series. They didn't get bad until like 1977. They traded Tom Seaver and all these other guys. It was terrible. But up until then, they were pretty competitive, but they were really good with Tom Seaver and all those pitchers and so on.
Nolan Ryan
and all that in the early 70s, late 60s.
And sometime in the early 70s, mm-hmm. I was young and impressionable.
Yep.
And I experimented with the Mets. and during that time, it was because I had a camp counselor that was a big Mets fan, and he kind of like mm-hmm. it was kind of a gateway drug, and I ended up dalliance there for a period of time. I think Rusty Staub was one of the players.
Yeah, he came. I think they traded for him in 72.
Yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But that didn't last long. You know, I kind of admitted that I had a problem. I went through a process, and I got back very quickly to the Yankees, and I've been a Yankee fan ever since. So,
what's interesting, because what I remember, you saying something like that you started off for a Mets fan, or you were a Mets fan for a while, you thought about it, something like you're saying now. And it's interesting how you're saying when they were good or not good. They got bad, you know, in 76, the Yankees got really good. You know, they went to the World Series that year, right, I think. And then they lost to the Reds in four games, but they had a good team. They started. That's when the dynasty awoke again for a period of time. Mm-hmm. But I remember you telling me this, that you know you decided you wanted to become a Yankee fan because you wanted to be with a winner. And then is that any truth to that? Because I remember you
Not
saying
really,
that.
No, because when I converted to the Yankees, that was like in the Dave Winfield Mattingly days when I stuck with them all through that dry stretch where they had this terrible run where we had a couple individual stars, but the team just couldn't work together. And it was some pretty lean years. And I was there through thick and thin, pal.
That was maybe then. But when you started when they were winning, though, didn't you? Like,
I do remember that when I first became like really into the team, there were two things that actually got me really mm-hmm. into the team. The first as a kid was when they finally beat the Royals in the ALCS, and when Chris Chambliss hit that home run walked off. I remember that, and Chris Chambliss was my favorite player back then. And that was a big thing. And then the other thing was 9/11. So right after 9/11, mm-hmm. when things were really dismal, and we were kind of like today in a in kind of a surreal environment where we didn't know what was happening with the world and if we were safe. And then the Yankees were playing the Diamondbacks that year in the World Series, and they had these just magical games where they had these walk-offs, and you know, when the president came and threw the first pitch at Yankee Stadium wearing a bulletproof vest, and Derek Jeter told him, don't throw a bad pitch, they'll boo you. That was his advice to George W. Bush. But you know, that was when the Yankees were kind of representing New York after everything New York went through. And I remember you told me, now this is your mm-hmm. moment of semi-betrayal that we have to dig up. Mm-hmm. You said to me, I remember we talked about this, you said that after 9/11, when the Yankees were playing the World Series, mm-hmm. that you thought, you know, maybe I should support them because they're playing with New York across
the you're right. That's a long time. That's a long time after being a little kid, though. And what I was getting at, and I'll go back to that, but the point I want to make here is that I remember you saying, this is what I remember, that you said you wanted to be with the winner, and that's why you chose the Yankees. And I said, when someone asks you who your favorite team is, with that kind of response, that you want to be with the winner, what you tell them is, I'm sorry, I'm not a baseball fan. Because you got to stick, you know, it doesn't matter if the team's winning or not. You're supposed to stick with them. So that's no way to choose a baseball team because they're winning. I mean, you know.
Anyway. I was a young, impressionable kid. I was easily led astray. Yeah. What can I tell you?
Well, there's a couple with my Yankee, and I really admire the Yankee organization now. But when I was a kid, I grew up, my father was sort of he was a baseball fan, but he actually rooted for the Yankees when he was a kid, because everyone, you know, he grew up in upstate New York, and he liked Joe DiMaggio. Every Italian guy, you know, loved Joe DiMaggio. Mm. There's another story that came to mind that I won't tell right now, but all the Italians love Joe DiMaggio. But, you know, the real baseball influence on me was my Uncle Romeo, who was still alive. He's 98 years old, and he was a New York Giants fan. And back in New York, a lot of where the rivalry for you and I stem from is with baseball for us as fans, is going back to New York from the 20s or earlier even. After World War I, when baseball became very popular, the three New York teams, and baseball kind of solidified at that point where the teams were, the Brooklyn Dodgers, New York Giants, and New York Yankees shared New York City and were good. And generally, the Yankees were in the World Series most of the time and playing against either the Dodgers or the Giants. And so there was this huge rivalry. And my uncle grew up in Queens at that time, I guess, is where his family, after he came from Italy, where he grew up as a kid, and he rooted for the New York Giants. He was a huge New York Giants fan. And so he hated the Yankees, and he didn't like the Dodgers either, but they truly hated the Yankees. My cousin Paul said when they would get these cards, you know, like Mickey Mantle baseball cards are worth so much money?
Yeah.
So when he was a kid growing up, because my uncle passed this on to him, my cousin's 12 years older than me, but he said when he was growing up and he'd get a Mickey Mantle card, you know, in the baseball cards, they'd rip it up. So they would get Mickey Mantle, they'd rip up Mickey. Imagine those things are worth a lot of money now. But they just, that's the way they just hated. They hated the other teams. If you rooted for one and hated the other.
Let me tell you something. The feeling is mutual, okay? Because let me tell you this. So I was getting married in Hawaii. Mm-hmm. And so this was 2002, I guess. So we're out there in Hawaii, and we're out there, I got my whole family there. And we knew that you were up in space. This was during, I guess this is your first mission, right? Was that about the right
March
time?
March of 02.
'02, there you go.
Yep.
So you're up there in space in the shuttle going to the Hubble, and we found out that, like, you know, the shuttle, you can see it. The shuttle, the space station, even the Dragon, you can, even a small capsule, you can see it if the timing is just right and it's lit up by the sun, where it's dark where you are. So it's like right after sunset or just before sunrise, but it's high enough that it's being lit up by the sun and you can see it. And this was going to happen. The conditions were just right on this one morning, like a couple days before the wedding. So we got the whole family out there on the beach in Hawaii. And it's actually beautiful. We wake up early before dawn. We go out there. We're standing on the beach with the sound, just the sound of the waves and the wind blowing. And we gaze up, and there is the space shuttle. And what it looks like is like a very bright star flying rapidly through the sky. Like, it takes about 5 minutes to go from horizon to horizon. And it's just really a cool thing to see. And we're gazing up at that. And then one of my my sister-in-law, who's from Brooklyn, she says, hey, wait a minute. Isn't this that one with the Mets fan on there? And I'm like, yeah, Mike Massimino. Yeah, yeah, he's a Mets fan. And my whole family starts booing. Boo! Like they, I'm like, you can't boo the space shuttle. That's not cool. And they're like, boo, you know, and flipping the bird and whatnot. And they didn't care it was a space shuttle. They just knew it was a Mets fan on there and they were going to boo him.
There you go. What are you going to do? What are you going to do? Yeah, that's how I got to, when I was a kid, not to like the Yankees, was that my uncle, I was a little kid, like you're saying, you play with the kids in the neighborhood and you say, hey, this is a good team. And some Yankee fan, Met fan, Bobby Mercer was very popular back then. Mm-hmm. And I remember being at my uncle's house. He lived in Queens and we were over there. We used to go over there a lot, lived nearby. And I remember he was drinking like a, I don't know, water or something. And I was a little kid looking up at him. And I was like, hey, Uncle Rome, what about the Yankees? They're a good team too, aren't they? And he's drinking this water. And he just spits all this water out all over the kitchen. He's like, and he looks down at me and he points his finger at me. And he goes, any Yankee fan is no friend of mine. I was like, okay.
Oh, wow.
And that was it. So that's how I got scared into it. And I was like, okay, I'm a Mets fan. So, and that was, you know, right at the time they started to not play very well. But yeah, that's how it started for me. But over the years, so you mentioned 9/11. So the Yankees were playing. I remember I was training for my first flight then pretty heavily. And, you know, there was a lot going on in New York City. And I was like, well, you know, this would be kind of cool to see the Yankees win for New York. So I called my Uncle Ron. I speak to my uncle every week or so we'll usually speak about something. So I call him up and I go, hey, you watching the World Series? What do you think? And I go, yeah. I go, you know what, Uncle Rome? Maybe wouldn't it be bad? You know, this is a long time after. You know, this is since I was I was in my late 30s now. You know, it's been about 30 years since he pointed that finger in my face and told me that. And my aunt's on the phone too. My aunt Ann's on the phone too. They're both of them, you know, on the speaker, which is kind of comical with them. But anyway, my aunt and uncle, the Oprah, what? Oh, that's it. You know. So I was like, what do you think? What do you think? Maybe it'd be good for New York for the Yankees to win after all we went there. And they're like, what? Are you out of your mind? What is wrong with you? Absolutely not. And then my Piazza was the next Italian player that they liked. You know, because Piazza was on, it was, and he's like, after what Clemens did to Piazza, blah, 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 blah. I'm like, okay, all right, something's never changed. It softened me up, Garrett. I was like, well, I'd like to see him win for New York at a tough time. But there was no persuading my Uncle Romeo. It was like, I don't care what happened. I'm not rooting for those guys. They're a terrible team. They're terrible. So, and they ended up losing, unfortunately, for the Yankee fans and for New York, they ended up losing anyway. But
yeah,
anyway.
Yeah. I rationalize that as saying that, like, for a moment there, it was like it was so cathartic and it was so uplifting to see this New York team, the Yankees, who are not favored, going up against Schilling and Randy Johnson at the top of their game. You know, this and somehow these miracle, they all these like the extra innings victories. You know, Martino Martinez has that home run and like. All these last minute heroics and the mystique and aura. I remember talking about that in the stadium and everything that you start thinking like this will like make everything better. If the Yankees just win the World Series. And of course, no sports victory could ever possibly address a tragedy like 9/11. And I've seen people fall, like get their hopes and dreams wrapped up into a team's sports victory and think that that makes things okay in real life, and it doesn't. All right, there's no way. And so I rationalized the loss in that World Series. That was a heartbreaking loss with Mariano Rivera, you know, being blowing the save in the end there, and this kind of bloop single that was like this, that with Jeter playing in and it just barely going over his head. Yeah. and everything about that just seems so ill-fated that I think that was a reminder from up above that. That winning a World Series does not erase 9/11, right? Hey, just remember, it's a stupid game. It's just a game, and it's not going to make everything all right. I think that was kind of a reminder at the last minute when we kind of were getting too wrapped up into this catharsis that is not reality, you know.
I don't know. I just
anyway, that's, it was, my, that's my story. I'm sticking with it.
No, that's pretty, I mean, you're right, but I think it was more just it was Mariano Rivera was hard to hit, and as I've heard Joe Torre say, if they were going to hit him, it was going to be weak, and that's what happened. They got a weak shot off of him that found the hole, and that's what happened there. But no, you're right. You know, we tried on my flight. I flew soon after 9/11, and we took a bunch of stuff. Well, we could talk about that sometime too. What we did on that flight, my father. Well,
that'd be good to go into because I know you took the home plate right for
That was another flight. Yeah, that was there. But as far as the 9/11 thing, my father worked for the New York City Fire Department. So, and he passed a couple of years before I was before I got to fly in space. He was alive when I was selected as an astronaut. But so we did a lot to try to pay tribute to the firemen and the policemen that were lost on our flight. So I was glad we had a chance to do that. But you did, you know, the Yankee thing though, two things happened to me to make me realize that, your stance on baseball and I'm going to the Yankee game this Friday, by the way. I love going to baseball as Mets or Yankees, but I was in Israel, like you've been there more than I have, I think. But I was there on one trip. It was a year after the Columbia accident, and I get picked up at the airport from a guy who worked for the embassy, right? Because when we went over there, they took care of us.
Yeah.
And some guy meets me and goes, he shows me his ID, so I'm here with the embassy. I'm here to pick you up, and he goes, and the ambassador heard that you're a baseball fan and you're from New York. This is the U.S. ambassador to Israel, right? So he says you're from New York, and he wanted to know Mets or Yankees. And I said, well, I'm a Mets fan. And he goes, he's a Yankees fan. I go, that's too bad. So I meet the guy. We're at this thing. It was an Alon Ramon event. You know, there was I think it was, it might have been, it was more than 1 year after the accident. I think it was 2 years after the Columbia accident. It was in 05. And was it 05? Maybe it was 06. I don't know. It was a year. Maybe it was, no, it was 05. Anyway. Okay. I meet the ambassador, the American ambassador to Israel. Mm-hmm. And he goes, I hear you're, he says, I hear you're a Mets fan. I go, I hear you're a Yankees fan. I go, I got to tell you, I'm not a Yankees fan. I really don't like that team, blah, 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 blah. And he goes, he's just listening to me, and this guy, he's an ambassador to Israel, right? So
he's a diplomat.
He's got people, he's used to people not getting along.
Yeah, he's dealing with Israelis, Palestinians. And
right, he's dealing with all this stuff, right? And then I come in here talking about baseball. And so he looks at me and he goes, well, it is true that I am a Yankee fan, but I don't wish your team any harm like you do mine. And I was like, holy cow, this is the right guy for that job. And he's right. this is the right guy to have in that job. I go, you're a real good ambassador. And then to tie in a little bit baseball and space, on the 50th anniversary of Apollo 11, I get a call from the Yankees. They're looking for an astronaut to throw out a pitch.
Oh yeah, right?
And Yankees, and I'm like, I go, oh yeah, By this point, I'm like, this is a great thing to do. I'm not going to pass this up, Yankee Stadium. And it was they did it right. They said they don't have very many first pitches. They only do a couple a year. It's not like they don't do it for people for endorsement reasons. They do it for the right reasons, which is to honor something. And this was Apollo 11. I was like, this is really cool. And they got this guy, Jack Aker, who was on the mound, right? He was going to be, at first I thought I was going to be, Garrett, I don't know the last time you threw out a pitch, but it had been a couple years for me. And at the time I was coaching, the first time I did these things, I was coaching baseball for my son, and I was throwing batting, I was the batting practice pitcher, I loved doing it. So no problem grooving in it didn't have to be fast, just grooving and hitting the catcher's
head
from the mound was not a problem. But it had been a couple years, this just happened a couple years ago. And I hadn't thrown a ball, I think, in a while. And, our shoulders had gotten so much wear and tear from the EMU, that I got
from the spacewalks.
I was like, oh, my God. And I couldn't. And I tried throwing a baseball. I couldn't even, throw 10 feet. And I was practicing for days trying to do this. And I'm like, oh, man. And I finally got it right before, the Friday before. It was a Saturday game. I went down to Riverside Park with a bucket of baseballs. And I finally figured out a way with what was going through my mind and my arm motion that I could get it to reach the plate. It's like, thank God. But I was like, thank goodness I'm going to have, a professional baseball player catching this. Because usually we can do, again, a whole episode on first pitches, good and bad. But I was like, at least I have a professional baseball player. So 2 days before, so I'm struggling with this, about 2 days before, the Yankees call me up And the guy says, Mike, we've got some exciting news. I go, what's that? He goes, Jack Aker, who was the pitcher on the mound on Yankee Stadium when they landed on the moon. It was an afternoon game. And you know, they had this clip of on the moon, and Jack Aker's on the mound. He's going to come to the game. And I go, that's great. And he goes, and he's going to catch your first pitch.
Uh-oh.
And I'm like, how old might Mr. Aker be? And he goes, he's 82 years old. So I'm like, hey, can he, you know, I'm sure, I know he's a great pitcher, and and he go, oh, no, I don't think he'll be fine. So he's in pretty good shape, this guy, right, Jack Aker, and he was there with his family, and was sitting. It was a beautiful day. It was a hot day, this July 20th, right, 2019. Mm-hmm. And he looks at me. I'm holding a baseball that I'm going to toss. And he goes to me, Mike, are you going to want that baseball after you throw it to me? And I'm like, well, yeah, Jack, but, you know, if you want it, you know, you can have it. And he goes, oh, no, I don't want the baseball. I'm just wondering if it gets by me, do you want me to go and get it? So this guy, you know, like, what kind that's of confidence good. Is this?
It's not inspiring, you know? Confidence, no.
Yeah,
no.
So I was like, no. Oh, my gosh. But I went out to the rubber. And I threw, and I got it, and I threw it right, and bang, got him a strike, right? He was like kind of hunched down a little bit, you know, 82-year-old guy. Bang, he caught it, you know, and he goes, hey, you had a natural spin on you. I go, really, you tell me this now? I would have wished I had known this when I was used to play in high school or something. It would have been a lot better to know that back then. But the whole, cool. The thing is, the Yankees were great, and they treated us really well. They gave us a suite, and it was so, so nice. Such a great organization. I met a lot of people that's a lot of them I met through you, but they're just a really classy organization, and I don't wish them any harm any longer.
That's
I
nice.
Wish
them all that's the best. Any longer. That's
I used
great.
To hate them when I was a kid.
But, I know, I'm sure.
But, yeah, but no, not anymore. I still root for the Mets, of course. The Mets are still my team.
Yeah,
I don't wish them any harm. Anyway,
I will say the same in the spirit of cooperation and goodwill. I will say the same thing about the Mets. I don't wish them any harm either. So unless we meet in another World Series, in which case then the gloves come off.
Then you got to root. Then you got to root for your team. You know, then you got to root for your team there. So,
but we should. I think we could wrap this episode up because we have a lot of first pitch stories. I'm thinking that's a whole episode on first pitch stories because I got a couple good ones from both Yankee Stadium and Dodger Stadium. But and I know you got a bunch more. But so let's avoid that. But let's talk about the stuff we took to space, because I knew when you started this, I think you took the home plate, right, from ship.
No.
Is that right?
Well, no, I did.
From City Field?
The first thing the first thing that happened to me is Ellen Baker, who was from New York City, her mom was a big Yankee fan. But her mom was Queensboro president. So in New York City, we have a mayor, but we have five boroughs, Brooklyn, Queens, Manhattan, Staten Island, and the Bronx. And each one of those has a president, which is kind of a borough president. It's a lot of people. There's millions of people living in each one of these boroughs. So the Queensboro president was her mom. Her name was Claire Shulman. And so she knew her, and the Mets play in Queens. So, and she knew I was a big Mets fan. And so when I got assigned, soon after I got assigned, she came up to me and she goes, what are you going to fly for the Mets? You know, congratulations on getting you. Sir. And I go, I don't know, something, you know, jersey. She goes, you should contact the team. I go, I don't know how to do that. She goes, I'll get my mother on it. Her mother knew everybody. So that afternoon, her mom schedules a call with me and the owner of the Mets, Fred Wilpon. And I get on the phone with him, and he says, oh, I'm a big supporter of the space program, and we'll send you whatever you want, you know, to take with you. And I go, I'd like a jersey. He goes, Piazza was the big player at the time on the team in 2002, and I said, well, really, I'd be very happy to take Piazza's jersey, but John Franco is the team captain, and his father worked for the city like my father did. His father was a sanitation worker, and he was from Brooklyn, and I felt more of an identifying with him as a New Yorker. I think Mike Piazza grew up in California and moved to New York. So they end up sending me John Franco's jersey, and so I took John Franco's jersey into space on my first flight. Mm-hmm. But the plate came as a result of what you were doing on your flight.
Oh, right. So on my very first flight, I didn't really take much at all for. No, I took a little bit of stuff for the Yankees. So my first flight, mostly I was thanking all the people that made it possible for me to become an astronaut. Right. So I took like stuff for my high school physics teacher, for the professor that was my PhD advisor at Caltech. I took, for my parents, for my family, I was my a lot of teachers, you know, I took stuff for.
Yeah.
And like my high school wrestling coach had his like his stuff for him. So and the only thing I took one additional thing from the Yankees, which is I took some dirt from the mound, because they had me out. We did a ceremony at the stadium, and Joe Girardi went out while we walked out to the mound. We scooped up some dirt right before the game, right from the mound, put it in a little jar, and I took that with me, and they gave me a banner. It was really nice, and I took that, and as I had some dirt from the pitcher's mound from Yankee Stadium with me, which I think got you going, and then I retaliated in my second flight. What did that do when you saw I had the dirt?
What was happening at the time, Garrett, you flew in 07, is that right? Was that your first flight, 07, 08?
08.
Oh, wait. Yeah. So let's get this right. 08 was the last season that both the Mets and Yankees played in those stadiums. That was the last year the Mets had been at Shea Stadium. I don't know, at that point, less than about 40, 45 years or something maybe. And the Yankees had been in Yankee Stadium, the house that Ruth built, since the 20s. And now they were closing these. Both of these stadiums the same year were getting wrecked. And they were building new stadiums. So what you did was not only fly dirt. I mean, I thought this had part of what you were, your inspiration for it too, was that they were taking down Yankee Stadium.
Yeah.
And you flew dirt from the old stadium.
That's right, I did.
Yep. But let me ask you this. That stadium was not the same stadium they had that Ruth was in, because they redid that stadium back in the 70s. In 75, 76. Yeah, they did. So it wasn't really the same stadium. To me, it was a completely different stadium.
But the foundation was the same. It stood on the same ground. The foundation was the same. You don't paint your house and say, "Oh, I got a new house."
They didn't. What do you mean? But paint? They took the thing down. If you look at the old stadium,
no,
it doesn't look anything like down. The new one.
They built the '70s. They built the upper deck basically on top of it.
The entrance to this may look like a spaceship. The second Yankee Stadium. Anyway, that's a whole nother thing. But whatever that was, they knocked it down. But that was it. So they were tearing down Yankee Stadium and building a new stadium the same year the Mets were doing it. So you had that. I thought it was a brilliant idea to pay. I thought you were doing to pay tribute. You do have a lot of good ideas, and I try to steal all of them if I can. So I was like, this is a pretty good idea to pay. They're tearing the stadium down. You know, I could, you know, whatever. Maybe I could do something for, instead of doing something just for a player. You know, John Franco, I think, for my first flight, I see him every once in a while out. He's out here in Long Island. I see him in New York.
Oh, cool.
I see him at the game. I'm still in touch with him. He's a fun guy to run into. He's just a fun guy, good guy. and he's got this shirt, I think, at home that I flew in space. Right? He's got it in his, you know, one of his study or something, which is kind of cool. But I was like, I'd rather do something for the whole team this time, you know, that kind of symbolizes the team and the fans. And so I call up the guy from that I knew, Jay Horowitz, and I'm still friends with, from the Mets, the PR director there. Mm-hmm. And I said, hey, Jay, you know, my friend is flying dirt from Yankee Stadium. Did you hear about this? And he was pretty in tune with what was going on around New York and baseball. And he goes, yeah. He goes, Mike, I heard about the dirt. We can do better than dirt. This is what he tells me. We can do better than dirt. I go, what do you think? He goes, you want to take a pitcher's mound or a home plate? And I go, I don't, you know, what do you, you know, this is kind of, those are kind of big.
The whole mound?
Well, the pitch, the rubber. Truthfully, he would have sent me whatever I wanted, I think. So I say to him, why don't I do a little research into this? And so the pitcher's mound is kind of, if they would have sent me just the rubber, let's say, somehow, if they could send me that, that was pretty long, you know? But yeah. I looked at the dimensions of a home plate, you know, major league home plate dimensions. So it was like, I think it's like 17 inches from top to bottom, you know, from the point to the back. And then the width of it is also 17 inches. And we can check this at home, kids, if you want. But it was like 17 inches by 17 inches. So I get the guys, I was talking to this. We had like a, what we cut, you know, like a training prep, you know, a prep and post, one of these things. Well, we say prep and post, it's like, you know, the prepping the cabin or post EVA or whatever. Well, we had something we were going to be in a simulator with our lockers, and the goal was to try to get whatever we were going to take with us to fit inside of a locker.
Yeah.
So I was talking to this to some of the guys in the facility, and they're like, we'll make you a mock-up. So these guys go and look up the dimensions of the home plate, and they make out of cardboard. You know, while we're inside the facility, they give me a mock-up of a home plate, and the width of the locker was like 17 and a half inches or 17 and three quarters. It like fit perfectly in the locker. We needed to be able to fit in a locker in our what we call a right. special flight data file locker. So as long as I get fit in there, it's flat. It'll fit in there. It's fine. So I call Jay and I go, we did a little test today. Send the plate. So he sends me the plate, Garrett. Mm-hmm. But what the plate he sends me is a used plate, right? It's got dirt on it, cleat marks. It's like looks like a. It's just unbelievable, right?
Yeah.
And then it's got a black. It's got the black stripe around, you know, the black rubber around it.
Right.
I'm like, oops. The measurements and the mock-up were just for the white part
yeah.
of it, right?
Yeah.
So the first thing is this thing gets delivered to my house, and my son, who's a baseball fan, looks at it, and it had the dates on it. It was used like the end of the season in 2017. He's like, Dad, you can't fly that thing. It's bad luck. That's when the Mets folded. The Mets had a big yeah. lead in 2017. They folded. You can't fly that. It's yeah. bad luck, Dad. I go, what am I going to do? I got to fly this. But I don't know how I'm going to fit this thing in the lock. It doesn't fit because it has the black stuff around it. So like some of the guys on my crew that weren't really baseball fans were like, why don't you just cut it and take a piece of it? I go, would you just take a piece of the Mona Lisa? You can't cut this thing. We're not going to take a piece of it. So, and I didn't want to mess with the plate at all. So what I thought I could maybe do is remove the black from and just fly the white part of it, right?
Yeah.
And I asked Jay, he goes, well, you know, we'll trust you, Mike, whatever you want to do. I go, that's a mistake. So I called the manufacturer was Shut Sports. And I called them up or wrote them a letter or something that said, look, do you have any extra of these home plates hanging around that you don't need that I can test with? I want to try it.
Right.
And they were like thrilled for the space program. So they sent me a few of these plates. And I called Don Pettit up, our good friend Don Pettit, who had this amazing machine shop in his garage.
Yeah.
And was very mechanically inclined. And I told him the problem I had. I go, Don, do you think there's a way we could just... So he looks at... I go to his house one Saturday. This is what we worry about in spaceflight, folks. This was the big project we had. So he looks at this.
Yeah,
thing
shouldn't
and goes,
be like be training. Shouldn't
right,
be
we're supposed to. I'm worried about how am I going to get this. How am I going to get this?
You're
space,
worried about this plate.
This plate in onto the space shuttle because it has to fit in the locker, right? Or else I'm doomed. I can't go put it anywhere else. So Don looks at this thing and he realizes that it's held on with a very thin piece of rubber, right, or that is closer to the plate. And he says, and I go, whatever you do, we got to put it back together again. Right?
Right.
We have these practice plates to practice on. So he says, if I take a really sharp blade, I think I can get through that rubber and just remove it, and then we can put it back on and epoxy it when you come back from space. And it won't, you know, it'll look great. So I go, okay, and we practice and it works. So then it comes time to do this to the real plate, right? And Don like hands me the knife and I go, I can't operate on my own child. It's got to be all you, Don. I'm not touching this thing. This is a, you know, major league plate, you know, Shea Stadium. Yeah. I'm not messing with this thing. So he goes and cuts the thing off. The black stays home. I fly the white part of the plate to space, you know, just the main part. And we take pictures and all that. We get back, we glue it back on, and then I got to return it to the team. So
that's cool. But remember,
that's where it went. But that's the way
do
the
you remember plate what I said when I heard you were doing this? Remember what I told you? Which is,
no, tell me.
Because you're right, Mets folded that year. It was a bad year for the team.
Yeah.
So I said, yeah, that's a good idea, Mass. You know, take the home plate from the stadium. Was it from Shea or from Citi Field?
It's from Shea. It was from the old stadium.
From Shea.
It was
the
from
Shea. Right, yeah. Right.
Yeah.
So I said, yeah, that's a good idea, Mass. The only way you're going to stop the opposing teams from scoring on the Mets that year was to take the home plate and launch it into outer space.
Yeah, I think they would have figured it out. They would have done something. But it was cool looking at that thing. I had to get approval to fly this thing. So the Mets gave me a letter that it was going to be, shown at the new stadium and all this other stuff. But Jerry Ross, I remember, you remember our friend Jerry Ross, this very veteran, legendary spacewalker, was the head of the vehicle integration team at that time.
Mm-hmm.
So I had to get his approval to fly this thing. And at first he was like, what are you talking about? You're going to fly it. I go, let me show this thing to you, Jerry. And Jerry looks at this thing. Once you looked at this thing, you saw that there was dirt on it. There were cleat marks on it. And he's looking at this thing and he goes, Mike, did I ever tell you I was a catcher in Little League? This is like the most grizzled thing. And I go, really?
Yeah.
Jerry goes, we got to figure out a way to get this on board, Mike. This is great. And we also took it to the NBL with us and to show some, to take pictures with it at the NBL and our spaces.
Yeah.
And these guys in the NBL loved it, and they said, why don't we take it underwater? And I go, you can't take that underwater. It's got dirt on it. Well, I'm flying it. That dirt's got, you know, it's authentic.
It's part of
and
the
they
history.
Bagged it. They bagged this thing, and you know, that like that purplish looking rubber, you know, stuff they would bag our tools in and stuff. And they bagged it, and we had it under, Brano and I had it underwater with us to take photos. So it was really
it's cool.
Ended up being really a fun thing. But really, the idea of flying some for the stadium was sort of getting that. You flew the dirt, I flew the home plate. Yeah, you know, again, it was the Mets Yankees thing.
On my second flight, I took a bunch more stuff for Yankees. And then this time I went a lot for the individual players. So I had Bernie Williams' glove. He gave me his glove.
Really?
I had Whitey Ford's jersey. He gave me gave me a bunch of his jerseys. We flew a bunch of them.
Cool.
And I gave it back to him after the flight. I had, what else? I had Roger Clemens' hat. I'm trying to think of what other play. I had a bunch, but I had the main one I was probably most proud of and most protective of was Joe Torre's World Series rings from 2000. Because my second flight was in 2010, so it was a 10-year anniversary of that World Series victory over the Mets. Just want to bring that up again. In 2010. Yeah. And
2000, I think it was.
What's that?
The World Series?
No, I'm sorry. The World Series was in 2000.
Right,
okay. This is 2010.
So right, 10 years after. Yeah, perfect.
10 years after. I asked him what he wanted me to take, mm-hmm. and he said, take this. And he takes off his World Series ring from 2000. And I'm like, oh, man, I don't know. And I'm like, my commander was Ken Ham, and Ken is all worried about it. He's like, what if we lose that thing?
Yeah.
That thing's like really valuable. What if it floats away? We're going to have to stop the mission, shut down the space shuttle, and have the all hands on deck searching for it because we can't afford to lose that thing. And I told that to him, and, you know, he's got a lot of class. So Mr. Torre was like, he goes, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. If my ring is lost in space, that's pretty cool, and I'm fine with it. So just do the mission. Don't stop anything. So I had that ring with me, and I actually wore it out. This I probably shouldn't have done this, but I actually when we came back from that and we landed the Space Shuttle Atlantis, we went out to a local bar.
I was with you.
Called. You were there.
I was there. You landed. Yeah. I got to try on the ring.
But you're wearing it. Yeah. I was wearing the ring. I was wearing Joe Torre's ring after we landed from space at Fish Lips, the bar we went to. So there's a lot behind that. And I'll tell you what, we're kind of out of time for today.
Yeah. I've got,
so how about next episode, we tell the Joe Torre story about,
we can tell
about
Joe
how
Torre.
We both got to know him.
I want to finish with one more thing, though, if you don't
mind. Sure, go.
You mentioned the stuff you flew for players. Did you fly something for Mattingly? Did you fly something for Don Mattingly?
No, actually, I did not, because I met him after I came back from my last flight. So it was it was too late. Yeah.
Okay. No.
What am I talking about? No, I did fly. So, no, I'm sorry. I got that backwards. I did fly. I flew his Dodgers jersey.
All right.
And I flew a Dodger jersey for Joe Torre too when they were both coaching the Dodgers.
All right.
I took stuff up for them. That's right.
Because the reason
I
bring that up, Garrett, and we can end with this if you want after you hear it. But I was at a game. Again, the Mets were playing the Dodgers at Citi Field. This is when Mattingly now was the manager. This is about maybe four or 5 years ago. Now he's managing the Marlins, but he was managing the Dodgers years ago. And I'm there with my son on the field, and we're watching batting practice, and Mattingly sees us, and he remembers us, you know, from coming to – we could talk about all that, too, about when they came in. And I see him from time to time at different games, and he comes over to say hi. And he's talking to Daniel and I, and his son is there. His son Preston is with him, right? Uh-huh. And he goes, Preston, come here. You got to meet somebody. So his son, very nice kid, comes over. You know, he's about like 25 years old or something. And nice kid comes over, and he goes, Preston, I want you to meet Mike. Mike's the guy that flew my jersey in space. And I was like, no, it wasn't me. It goes, and he's going on and on about how I flew it in space and went to the space station. And I know it. I figured it's got to be Garrett that flew this thing. But I didn't know what to say. So I wasn't.
We really don't look alike, you and me. There's
I don't know how
key,
it happened.
Key differences.
But he's like, Mike flew my jersey in space. And you know what, Garrett? I hate to tell you. I don't think I've ever told you this before. I just shut up. It was too complicated to try to unravel it.
Oh, so I come on, man.
So that's if I see Don Mattingly again, I'll straighten
Don
it out.
Don Mattingly, for all of you that are out there listening right now, go find Don Mattingly and tell him, it was me. I flew your jersey. It wasn't this guy. And it was a short, bald guy, not the tall guy. How can he get
I tried it. Just got too involved. I was like, okay. That's it.
Oh, man, Don. Oh, oh, man.
All right.
I guess, you know, all astronauts kind of look alike, I guess.
We're a dime a dozen, you know?
I guess.
The guys are like baseball. How many can there be? So, all right. Well, I think we are really out of time, but thanks for hanging in there, folks. Thanks, Garrett.
All right. Thank you. See you next time. Remember to like and subscribe.
Like and subscribe. More important than listening.
That's right. Like, give us some nice ratings. Give us some cool comments. The comments are always fun to read.
Yes.
So thank you very much for listening.
Thanks very much, folks.
See you next time on Two Funny Astronauts.